Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you that we can come here to meet in your house once again this morning. We pray, Lord, that you will be with each person here today. Help us open our hearts and our minds to take in the word that your pastor brings us today. We pray, Lord, that we can take this word and we can go out and live our lives in a way this week that others might see you in us. These things we pray in our loving name. Amen.
Amen.
I'd like to open this morning with hymn number three. As far as announcements today, the flowers in the sanctuary are given in memory of Maxie Moles for his birthday and anniversary on October the 12th, given by the family. There'll be choir practice tonight at 6 p.m., praise group on Monday at 7 p.m., Wednesday Bible study at 10 a.m., and 6:30 p.m. Next Sunday, we'll have a baptismal here on Sunday morning. That will be after the service or before? It'll be during the service next Sunday morning. I'd like to welcome everyone to that. The Lunenburg County Ministries is having a Brunswick stew Saturday, October the 21st. It's $10 per quart. They would like for you to pre-order and call Lunenburg County Ministries at 676-6515 or contact any of the county ministries board members. I believe Dana's on that, I believe.
There's a sign-up sheet in there on the bulletin board.
They have a sign-up sheet on the bulletin board in here. The Kimmeridge Fire Department's observing Fire Prevention Week today, October 15th. Go by the firehouse. You can read that in your bulletin, all that they've got going on up there today. Mark your calendar for the Fall Festival at the Parish Pumpkin Patch on Sunday the 22nd at 4 p.m.
Read that next sentence.
The price of admission is a bag of canned food for the Lunenburg County Ministries. Membership committee sponsors this. Randy Lael, Michael Wilkerson, Carrie Parrish, Wayne Wallace, and Beverly Hawthorne comprise the nominating committee for 2024. Any suggestions from the congregation must be received by them no later than November the 17th. The annual church meeting will be on December the 17th, following the worship service. Do we have any other announcements this time? If not, most of you know that this week has been Pastor Recognition Week, and we would like to recognize our pastor. Don, you stand up, please. I have a confession to make before I give this to Don. Donna, we really appreciate you being here. We appreciate everything you do for our church. And we've collected a little something for you this week. The confession is the basket is not yours.
Well noted.
If I give this basket away, I'll have to leave town. The contents are yours, and we certainly appreciate all you do for us. Donna's mother, Carolyn Edwards, Mike Mason, Bubba Spencer, John Washburn, and we have a praise group. There's another John Hawthorne in the world. Y'all believe that. John William Hawthorne III. We'd like to send congratulations to Uncle Robbie and the Hawthorne family. Are there any others at this time?
And Tiffany Thompson.
Tiffany Thompson. Are there others? I'd like to remember all these people in your prayers this week. After our meditation morning prayer, our communion hymn will be hymn number 483.
Let us pray. Almighty gracious loving God, we just give you thanks that we are able to approach your throne. And we thank you for our many blessings, and we thank you for loving us and providing us with guidance and love, with forgiveness and shelter and laughter and strength, friends and family, healing and peace, grace and mercy, food and drink, art and music that delight us, sights and sounds like falling rain and fall leaves, transportation that provide us access to where we need to be. We thank you for doctors and nurses, therapists, soldiers and sailors, and emergency personnel that risk their lives for us, for the teachers that listen and encourage our children and grandchildren, for caring for our youngest to our oldest member here in our church family, for providing us with children which we care for and pray over, we give thanks. For our family and friends that need your healing touch, both physically and emotionally, we give thanks that we can approach you and that you hear our prayers. Lord, we pray for the Middle East. We pray for your people. We pray for healing to those who have been wounded. We pray for strength to be able to endure. And we pray for hope that one day the end of violence, the end of war, that we will see one day, and that violence will be no more on this earth. We pray in a special way for this peace, dear Lord, this morning. And we pray for the names that you have heard. You know their needs and you know their suffering. And we ask for you to be with those who need your care. And as a great physician, we ask you to touch them with healing, Lord. And Lord, we thank you for our many blessings. And we thank you for the blessing of a new birth. And we thank you for the blessings that we have received this past week. We know that your love is great. We know your provisions is mighty and wonderful, and we give you thanks. We ask you to cover those that we love and our neighbors in this community, in this world. Cover them and touch them with healing, Lord, and provide us with the words and actions necessary to encourage them when they're feeling defeated by this world. Lord, sometimes our needs are so private, and sometimes we don't even have the words to be able to ask for prayer. And so, Lord, we ask you this morning just to look into our hearts, and we ask you to listen to our hearts for the needs that we personally have this morning. Let us silently allow those needs to reach you. Lord, we pray the prayer that your Son, Jesus Christ, taught us to pray, praying together, Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those that trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. This morning we come to the table. We come to the table of grace. And this is the Lord's table, and Christ invites you to share his meal. And Christ recognizes you, and he looks upon you with favor. Christ befriends you and wants you within his circle, wants you at the table together. Count yourself, dear friends, this morning among Christ's disciples by partaking together in this feast of fellowship. Our hymn of communion is on page 483, The Savior is Waiting. Let us prepare our hearts and our minds for communion this morning. Mm-hmm. Jesus was betrayed. He took a loaf of bread, and after giving thanks, he broke it. He said, "Take, eat. This is my body given for you." And likewise, he took the cup, and after giving thanks, he said, "Take, drink, all of you, for this is the cup of the new covenant, poured out for many for the forgiveness of your sins. Do this in remembrance of me." And then he said this, "I will not drink of the fruit of the vine again until that day I do so again with you. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Come, let us share in his feast." the body of Christ given for you. The blood of Christ shed for you.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, every moment of the day is a blessing from you. Everything we see, everything we touch, everything we smell, everything we taste, all comes from you. For all these things, Lord, we are truly blessed and we are truly thankful. Now, this moment when we attempt to give back a portion of that which you have provided us, we ask, Lord, that you bless the gift, the giver, and the mission to which it goes. Amen.
That's right. Yeah. y'all come on and join me now. Oh man, we got a nice crowd this morning. How wonderful it is to have so many children. You think we can all squeeze in? Okay, so y'all two gonna sit on the back? Well, may I sit right here? Scoot over. She's not gonna bite you. You scoot over because I'm pretty good and big. I'm not little like y'all. Because we're gonna read a book. We always have to gather around when we read a book, don't y'all? So y'all can stand up back there and look over my shoulder. How about that? And y'all gather in real close. I won't bite either, I promise. It's called The Giving Tree. Have you ever heard the book before?
It's an apple.
Well, it looks like kind of an apple tree. Let's listen. Once there was a tree, see? And she loved a little boy. And every day the boy would come, and he would gather her leaves. Things of fall, don't we? And make them into crayons and play king of the forest. You know, ever play king of the forest? Or play them trees? Used to be my favorite thing to do, to play the trees. He would climb up her trunk. You see her climbing up? And swing from her branches and eat apples. And they would play hide and go seek. I don't know how the tree would find him, but he's hiding behind those little rocks. And when he was tired, he would sleep in her shade. And the boy loved the tree.
He loved to go in the tree.
Yes, he loves it.
But he went out in
the very, very much. And the tree was happy. But time went by. And the boy grew older. And the tree was often all alone. Then one day the boy came to the tree and the tree said, "Come, boy. Come and climb up my trunk and swing from my branches and eat my apples and play in my shade and be happy." "I am too big to climb and play," said the boy. "I want to buy things and have fun. I want some money. Can you give me some money?" "I'm sorry," said the tree, "but I don't have any money. I only have leaves and apples. Take my apples, boy, and sell them in the city, and then you will have money, and you will be happy." And so the boy climbed up the tree and gathered her apples and carried them away. And the tree was happy. The tree was happy to give them to her. But the boy stayed away for a long, long time, and the tree was very sad again.
Why?
And then one day, the boy came back, and the tree shook with joy and said, "Come, boy, climb up my trunk and swing from my branches and be happy." "I am too busy to climb trees," said the boy. "I want a house to keep me warm," he said. "I want a wife and I want children, so I need a house. Can you give me a house?" "I have no house," said the tree. "The forest is my home. But you may cut off my branches and build a house, and then you'll be happy." And so the boy cut all of her branches off and carried them away to build his house. Look at that.
It goes down now.
And the tree was happy. You think the tree was really happy to give everything that he had? But the boy stayed away for a very long time. And when he came back, the tree was so happy she could hardly speak. "Oh, come, boy," she whispered. "Come and play." "I am too old to play," said the boy. "I want a boat that will take me far away from here. Can you give me a boat? Cut down my trunk and make a boat. Then you can sail far away and be happy." And so the boy cut down her trunk and made a boat and sailed away.
And it warmed my heart now.
That's right. And the tree was very happy, but not really. The am sorry, boy, said the tree, but I have nothing left to give. My apples are gone. My teeth are weak for apples, said the boy. My branches are gone, said the tree. You cannot swing on them. I'm too old to swing on the branches, said the boy. My trunk is gone, said the tree. You cannot climb. I'm too tired to climb, said the boy. I'm so sorry, said the tree. I wish that I could give you something, but I have nothing left. I am just an old stump. I am sorry. I don't need very much now, said the boy. Just a quiet place to sit and rest. You think he's a little boy? What do you think he is now? He's an old man. Just a quiet place to sit and rest. I am very tired. Well, said the tree, straightening herself up as much as she could. Well, an old stump is a good place for sitting and resting. Come, boy, sit down and rest. And the boy did. And the tree was happy. Do you know that Jesus gave everything just like this tree did for us? And he was very happy to do it for us, wasn't he? Do you know of anything y'all could give back? You think you could give something back? Y'all are kind of young yet for giving back, aren't you? But you know what I think you could give? I think that you could give a hug to somebody in the church. Wait a minute, hand him a book. That's not mine. This is Caleb's book. So, I'm going to give you a supper. And I want you to go and give somebody in the church. Try not to be mommies and daddies or Ken, but that's kind of hard for y'all because y'all are kin to everybody here. Okay, here we go. A sucker, go give somebody a great big hug. Not a little gimpy one. A great big hug and make their day. Go choose somebody, anybody in the whole church. Okay, McKenna, not anybody that you can do. Got to give somebody in the church a great big hug. There you go. Oh. Oh, isn't that sweet? See, you can give of yourself all the time.
Dollar, we got bypassed on that one.
We did.
Thank you, Doris. We'll now be entertained by the praise group, after which Donna will bring the message.
Wow.
our dear, dear, dear family. We would not be together if it wasn't because we are the children of God. Amen?
Amen.
Wow. The Giving Tree, Doris, that was beautiful. Children, I know that it was easy to follow that story, and we look forward to when we march in, right? How good it is to be in the house of the Lord, how good it is to be brothers and sisters in Christ, and to come and worship the risen Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Our scripture this morning comes from the Gospel of Matthew, and we are in Matthew 22, verses 1 through 14. And I'm reading from the NRSV translation. Listen to the word of God. Once more, Jesus spoke to them in parables, saying, "The kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who gave a wedding banquet for his son. He sent his slaves to call those who had been invited to the wedding banquet, but they would not come. Again, he sent other slaves, saying, 'Tell those who have been invited, look, I have prepared my dinner. My oxen and my fat cows have been slaughtered, and everything is ready. Come to the wedding banquet.' But they made light of it and went away, one to his farm, another to his business, while the rest seized his slaves, mistreated them, and killed them. The king was enraged. He sent his troops, destroyed those murderers, and burned their city. Then he said to his slaves, 'The wedding is ready, but those invited were not worthy. Go there, therefore, into the main streets and invite everyone you find to the wedding banquet.' And those slaves went out into the streets and gathered all whom they found, both good and bad, so that the wedding hall was filled with guests. But when the king came in to see the guest, he noticed a man there who was not wearing a wedding robe, and he said to him, 'Friend, how did you get in here without a wedding robe?' And he was speechless. Then the king said to the attendants, 'Bind him hand and foot and throw him into the outer darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth, for many are called, but few are chosen.'" May God bless the reading and hearing of God's holiest word. Would you please pray with me? Almighty gracious Lord, may the words here this morning be pleasing to you, and may the meditations of our hearts be also. Amen. Our story today from Matthew is the last of the three parables in this section of Matthew, and it's dubbed as the Judgment Parables. And these three parables accuse the religious leaders of their hypocrisy and their disobedience, rejecting God's prophets, and is called the Parable of the Wedding Feast. It is also in Luke, you may remember the story. In the first century, when Jesus was teaching, it was a common practice to send out invitations way ahead of the party. But then an interesting practice that they would send out a courtesy reminder that went out on the day of the party. Not a bad thing, right? Two invitations for the same dinner. And God did, in fact, offer two invitations to the Jewish people and its leaders. The first, as you know, is the Old Testament covenant that Moses gave them, and where God's people agreed and they said they would follow the 613 laws of Judaism found in the book of Exodus, chapter 24, verse 3. The people agreed to the terms of the covenant. And the second invitation from God was the new covenant established through Jesus, the Messiah, that fulfills the new covenant and fulfills the intent of the first, but one that would also will declare the people forgiven through the body and blood of Christ. And Jesus is here among the Jewish leaders. He's here among these religious leaders, for they are refusing the second covenant with God's Son, accepting that Jesus is the Messiah, that was the one that was to come, and admonishing them for killing the prophets and Christian evangelists like John the Baptist, who foretold of Jesus' coming. So Jesus is telling the religious leaders a parable, a story with hidden meanings that actually reprimands and points the finger at them. In Luke's version, you can read and hear some of the excuses that they gave. First, that I have bought a piece of land and I must go out and see it. Please accept my regrets. Well, the land was already purchased, so it wasn't necessary for them not to accept the invitation. The next excuse was, I have purchased 5 yoke of oxen and I am going to try them out. Please accept my regrets. Again, the oxen have already been purchased, so that could have been delayed. And the third excuse seems to be legitimate in a way. This invited guest declares that I have just been married and therefore I cannot come. But Fred Craddock argues that newly married couples did not have the same responsibility as others, so it could have been a good excuse. But the Jewish community actually called upon the couple to begin working on their family, and the husband was even exempt from entering into military service. But Jesus here, who is the host of the banquet, did not excuse any of the 3 invited Jewish guests. In the final verse of this passage, Jesus is speaking, "For I tell you, none of those who were invited will taste my dinner." So now here comes the Christians to the party, the church. And the reason that we know that Jesus is talking about the church is because those who came accepted Jesus' invitation to this feast. Just like when we close our worship service each Sunday, we close it with an invitation to discipleship. And so lo and behold, they come. And the wedding hall is full. And we know that by church history. We know during and reading in Acts, thousands came to accept Christ. But there's one guest who Jesus is about to throw out, because this guest wasn't wearing the robe of righteousness. He wasn't wearing the proper wedding attire. In other words, he wasn't noted as being a Christian. It wasn't just about his clothes. It was about his failure to come to Jesus and to follow him and to give him glory in a manner that Jesus calls us to. So in other words, Jesus recognizes the good and the bad that was out in the community that he invited, and he recognizes them as now new believers that didn't recognize his one guest. He seems to believe that he can attend the wedding feast, the Lord's table in the kingdom of God, or talk about at the table during communion without any change on his part. He can just come willy-nilly and believe that he will be accepted no matter what. That he ignores how holy the Lord is, and he forgets how he is to be obedient to his call on his life. So Jesus is upset, and Jesus denounces him. Hearing that Jesus will now be included in the kingdom of God, and we somewhat talked about this morning in Sunday school, was tough news for the religious leaders of the people. Douglas Hare, who's a biblical scholar of the New Testament, writes that there is extensive evidence that Matthew was even deeply distressed by the mixed state of the church between Jews and Gentiles. But But it is by grace that we have been adopted through the body and blood of Christ. And even today, which is still somewhat amazing, to see how Israel is still slow to accepting Jesus as the Messiah, the one to come. The Pew Research Center reports that only 2% of the population of Israel are Christian. Israel is still God's chosen people, but the response to the church's invitation is slow. This parable is to convict the religious leaders, but it's also to encourage us to live the Christian life more vigorously. Jesus is still inviting people to the party, and the party will go forward. There will still be joy. There will still be those that are going out and doing the work of the church. Jesus is still inviting people to the party, and no matter what, no matter the state of one particular church or not, the party will go forward and the feast of kingdom will one day come and be ready for us. Jesus sees that the zest of Christians is not as strong as it used to be. So invitations and new ways to reach God's people still happen. And this parable is not to frighten Christians with the thought that the odds are against them, but to encourage that vigorous effort to live the Christian life. To remember when we come to worship that how holy God is. And we must not be content to limit the party to only people like us. Amen? We must evolve to reach others willing to come and pay honor to our risen Christ. We must keep the doors open to all the good and the bad, just as Jesus talked about. And the bad doesn't mean what we think. People that are highly, what we may think highly immoral. The bad simply means one that sins. And we are all sinners. Jesus included us. And Paul wrote to the early church in Rome and said in Romans 5:8 that while we were still sinners, Christ died for our sins. So how do we approach the throne of God? How do we approach the table entitled or with humility? I want to add a more modern illustration to further hear what I believe that Jesus wants us to hear today. About 25 years ago, when I lived in Charleston, West Virginia, I had the pleasure of being invited to a special statewide banquet celebrating foster parents. They so deserved the celebration, as in always. The event was held at the Tamarack Center in Beckley. Not sure if you've ever been there. It's a place known for, I'm sure, probably Larry has been there as a West Virginian for a while, at least at WVU. And the food was catered by the Greenbrier Hotel. That's one that we normally couldn't afford, but now the prices of all hotels are up, you know, you kind of question maybe we can now. The food was wonderful. And I sat down and I got to know several parents and their children during the celebratory five-course dinner event. But I heard grumbling. First one family, then another family. Apparently they weren't happy with the food. And at this point I heard several families begin to whisper, "Don't worry, we'll go to KFC after all of this." Grace. Yes, I understand that maybe the event planner should have considered the type of food that these hard-working, self-giving foster families would have enjoyed, but the important Christian response, however, for us as Christians, in a no reason not to believe that that hall was not filled with good Christians, but is to live with gratitude for what God has given, and to know where it came from, where it originated from. Gratitude for what was offered, what was prepared. And if we can practice this more often, and I as well, that here in our own life here on this earth, maybe it might, like the giving tree, to understanding the manner in which we should approach God and the church. Amen? When we take for granted what it means to have been invited to the kingdom of God, when we take for granted and ignore God's holiness and grace, we are just as insolent as this wedding guest that Jesus was harsh at the party. When Jesus invites, our response should be an appropriate response and not one of entitlement and a sense that we can continue to live as we want to live rather than how we are called to live. This week, I offer the challenge to identify those in which we can give thanks. Maybe it's not one person, maybe it's an organization, maybe it's a family. And you did practice it today because thank you. Thank you for this gift. But you still have the rest of the week. But thank you. Thank you for giving thanks. Thank you for giving thanks for our shared ministry. Thank you for letting me walk with you and for you to walk with me. And I like the Sunday before I came, about almost a year and the end of November. I remember Billy saying that at the end of his message, Donna may change us. But we may change Donna as well. I look forward to seeing what wedding garment we will be wearing years from now. Amen? Maybe it's not one person, maybe it's an organization, maybe it's a family. For in all things, as Christians, we believe that in all good things, it comes from God. And developing this spiritual muscle so that we can more freely remember to be grateful and give proper respect to our Lord and Savior. And I'm preaching this parable today because first, it's actually one of the lectionary readings for today, but also because we as Christians have a bad habit, and that's what it is, because we know that we are people of God, that bad habit of pursuing and protecting our lifestyles at any cost, at the expense of honoring God in the way that we should. And we did honestly. Our culture teaches us this is the way to live. And when we look at the world and we look at its problems, we recognize it. We recognize what we see today, and we sometimes can connect the dots. We see that our way is more important than God's way, or let's even say God's will for us. So if God's people, and we model, if we turn our focus towards God's will for the world, I believe with all my heart that one day the wars will be less than this. Anna Case Winters writes that the point of the story is not lost on the Pharisees. They understood that Jesus was pointing his finger at them. And at this point, and it says in verse 15, they plotted to entrap him in what he said. The Pharisees understood. Do we? Do we understand the glory? Do we understand how holy God is? The second round of invites is what gathers us today. It's what makes us a family. And a beautiful, beautiful family. One that works together, one that loves each other. And we come to worship a holy God each Sunday. for God who has invited us and adopted us as his children. We have been invited to the table by grace. And let us always remember as we gather in this church to do our best to follow Jesus' teachings. And let us continue to demonstrate our love for God and for God's people. Amen. Our hymn of invitation is on page 526, The Solid Rock. If you have not made a profession of faith, I invite you to come forward and do that if you are so led. And I would extend on behalf of this congregation, I will extend the right hand of fellowship. And it's as simple as that. And you will enter into this beloved community. And if you haven't been baptized, we will schedule that baptism. There are three of our young adults that are getting baptized next Sunday. Please know there's always room for you if you have not been baptized. Would you please rise together as the family of God and sing The Solid Rock, page 526. Come if you would like to make your profession of faith. Serving Christ.